Okay, thanks to you diehard fans that are still here. I've been handed three winning puzzle answers. And I have to tell you, I don't remember if I've done this in Canada before, but I'm going to tell you this anyway because I think it's correct. I think you're the brightest Canadian audience I've spoken to. Because I've used this puzzle again and again and again, probably for the last, I'm guessing, 33 or 34 years. And I hear this almost everywhere. Somebody up front here said, I've seen this before, but I can't remember it. And I'm going to use that as an example of how boxed in we are in our brains. We are boxed in. We are such creatures of habit. When we see something new, we sometimes can't remember the answer. And it's not a personal thing. It's okay. Oh, I didn't mean to do that part. So here we are. Connect all nine dots with four consecutive straight lines. What I loved is the person that gave me the winning answer, because he was first. I asked him how many times he tried. He said about 15. That is determination, and that's what we need to change as human beings. So here we are. The answer. Usually when I show this first slide, everybody goes, ugh. So let's write it. And true Canadians, you're a lot more withdrawn than some other audiences. Usually I show the first part. So, I mean, this is our brains, if they're arranged in a square, our brains just don't allow us to think. What, you mean open the gate and let the cows out? No, the fence is there to keep the cows in. In Colorado, we are a fence-out state, which means legally if your cows get out and get hit by a car, and I've had this personally happen, this happened to us. One morning at 6:15, our cows, well, part of our cows, one of our groups at our second dairy was walking across the road like they walked across the road at 6:15 every day for years when it's summer or grazing. And a guy on his way to work that takes that road every day ran into 80 cows crossing the road. There are cow crossing signs. It was broad daylight. And he said, for some reason, they blended in with the horizon and I just couldn't see them. And fortunately, our cows were okay. We had one with a couple broken ribs and she just kept on milking, didn't complain at all. One with a big hematoma up on her short ribs. And he kept calling me up and he gave me this litany about how there was something wrong that day. He couldn't see the cows. Well, you put out fluorescent orange cones on both sides. The people going across the road have flags they're waving. How could he not see the cows? And he was kind of expecting me to admit that it was my cow's fault and I would pay for his car that was totaled. And I said, how long you lived in Colorado? He said, I've lived here all my life. I said, do you know that Colorado is a fence-out state? Meaning, if you're driving in Colorado and there's livestock or wild stock on the road, it's your fault if you hit them. If you don't want the stock there, build a fence. Now, you can't do that on the road, but if you don't want stock on your land, you build a fence. Now, in modern-day society, we're having a little trouble with that. And so usually what happens is that the judge will say, Arden, they're your cows, and yes, it's a fence-out state, but the damage that your cows received, you are going to have to pay for. And the guy that ran into them is going to have to pay for his car. Insurance company wouldn't pay for that. They would not pay for him running into cows, which was kind of new to me. But you can have a black cow on a black road in a black night, and somebody hits it, and you're off the hook a little bit in the state of Colorado. So cows are meant to be inside fences, but your brain is not meant to be inside a fence, okay? And we can't help it, it's just the way we are. Outside the box thinking is the key to solving this puzzle. And I've had, I think I got four total answers now, and I hope there's more answers out there. Who else got this that didn't give me their paper? How many of you? Okay, that's six of you. And I'm gonna tell you, you're one of the smartest audiences I've ever presented this to. And that, I'm not sure what that means in the big picture, but it means something, okay? Exploring outside the box may prevent your heart attack. okay? Thinking outside the box may give you some results that you deserve, not just because you're thinking outside the box, but because you are trying. Don't just decide not to try. That's the end of that. Next one. Now, I probably have, on our website, there's probably, last count was 52 research summaries. And I probably have, I'm guessing, close to 500 in my computer. Now, I've not presented those in person, all of them, but you can get on our website and find a lot of this stuff. I always bring more. I brought 5 prepared talks today. I have time for 4. But I don't want to give up the 5th one. So we're going to go really, really fast. Your brain can process information 7 or 8 times faster than I can talk, no matter how fast I talk. That's why the puzzle works. You can do something else and still listen. Whether you can learn as fast is another thing. Again, Meg on the left. Okay. Flaxseed. I mentioned somewhere, no, I guess I skipped that slide, but flaxseed is important to cows too if they don't have pasture, okay, to get enough omega-3. They need omega-3. They are mammals. Very, very quickly, this is a summary of something that was in Progressive Dairyman. I looked up the individual studies, and I'm not going to present all that. Just going to present the summary that Dr. Ambrose presented. Here, we have a pregnancy survival graph for Holstein dairy cows, and it's pretty pathetic. We have an 85% conception rate that is normal if your cows are healthy. Not for scalf heifers. This is cows of all ages. 85%. You put semen in there, 85% of the time she's pregnant the next day. Okay? But then we have losses. We've got a 50% pregnancy loss in the first 2 heat cycles. That's really, really pathetic. But that's the way it is in Holsteins. This is only Holsteins. It doesn't apply to other breeds of cows because, as far as I know, the research hasn't been done. And then the last part of the loss we call fetal loss. And all we do here is just put a different term on it depending on how old the pregnancy is. But that's a heck of a lot of loss from 85% live calves down to 28%. And that's real life. Okay? Now, most of you in this audience will do like I do, and they say, shoot, as a veterinarian, I've palpated thousands and thousands of pregnant animals. I have neck arthritis. I have Meniere's syndrome that I think is connected to my neck arthritis. That's why I got a hearing aid the first time. Only one side. Due to using this arm to check cows for pregnancy. Too much of it. Repetitive motion disease. And you never think there's this much pregnancy loss. But that's because we don't check them when they're young here. You don't check cows 7 days after they're bred. Can't be done. Okay? This is through research of actually looking and finding out when the calf was aborted. So he looked at 5 studies that have been done thus far in Holsteins. I'm not aware of any other breeds so far. Locations, Alberta, Oregon, British Columbia, Quebec, Florida. Number of cows is there. The treated group got rolled flaxseed, whole flaxseed, or they got calcium salts of fish oil. So this one study is a little bit different. And the controls got other fats. I want to show you really what the pregnancy losses were in these studies as a summary. There they are. Alberta, as an example, the first study that was done had a 27% pregnancy loss in the control group and 10 in the omega-3 fed group. Man, that stuff catches my eye. If you don't have pregnant cows, you don't have calves born. If you don't have calves born, you don't have milk. You know, it's pretty simple. Those are p-values for statistics. Only two of these are statistically significant at the P less than 0.05 level. And what that means is, and you can't see that, and don't feel bad about that, but here, 95% of the time, that difference is a real truth, okay? That's a real truth. Because only 5% of the time, 5 out of 100 times, can that be wrong. This one here is P equals 20, meaning only 80% of the time would that be a reliable conclusion based on that study. There's 20% doubt in there. But when you look at all of them, and all of them had an improvement in pregnancy losses, then you start to say, oh, well, maybe this is real. Even though 4 were fed flaxseed and 1 was fed fish oil, if we average them all together, we end up with a 60% decrease in pregnancy losses if the cows have enough omega-3. Now, that's not shocking to me. On the one hand, they have an omega-3 requirement. And if nutrition is everything to cows and we don't feed them enough omega-3 and we take them off pasture, there's no chance to get any. It's going to affect something somewhere. And if we're smart enough to look, we find out that's a pretty big deal. Now, I wouldn't say that the conclusion is casting concrete yet, but it looks to me like there's a pretty good chance you can save pregnancies in your herd by feeding enough omega-3 to your cows. It'll save, based on that average result, save about 9 pregnancies in a 100-cow herd in a year. And I don't know about you, but I worked for a lot of 100-cow dairies. We had a 100-cow dairy ourselves, and we were producing raw milk. And if you can save 9 calves, that's a pretty big deal. Enough of that. Now, besides pregnancies, enough omega-3 levels improve udder health, it improves infectious disease control, and it improves, wrong button, energy status around calving time. Those things, along with the pregnancy losses, add up to a pretty big deal in my mind. We fed flaxseed to our organic herd back in, I think we started in 2003. And the next slide set, we're going to talk about our dairy. And I use it as an example because we've got a pretty unique situation. We're not just two veterinarians running a dairy. We're two veterinarians running a dairy that was first conventional, and then it was certified organic, and then it was raw milk, and then it was grass-fed raw milk. You might think we're a little crazy, and the answer is we are crazy. We started a conventional dairy because we wanted to continue doing research on dairy cows, like Meg was doing for her business when we met, but we wanted to own the dairy cows because in the situation we were in before, she had to go out and lease cattle from a dairyman. And it became increasingly difficult to come out and say, Bill, you're milking 2,000 cows in Colorado. You're close enough to me. I want to use 400 of your cows for 2 years. And I want to write you a check for renting your cows, 400 head, for 2 years. A lot of dairymen say, well, fine, what are you going to pay me? And then you start getting down to the details. A, you cannot change the ration on these cows without my permission. B, you can't use BST. C, you're going to breed those cows the way I want you to breed them for this study. D, we're going to take an hour a day to collect data on your cows, and they're going to need to be locked up for an extra hour a day. Pretty soon a dairyman says, no, not doing that. And then sometimes they say, well, yeah, I'm doing that. I'll sign the contract. But then a year and a half out, when you've done a $2 million study, $2 million have been invested by the company and the research that's being done, and then you say, I'm going to go broke if I don't do this. And you change everything. And you nullify the contract. And the research goes down the drain. And Meg's name is shit. So we thought, own the cows and solve that problem. So we did. We'd done everything else. The other day I figured up we have 81 years of combined experience with dairy cattle, and we've done almost every job known to man when it comes to a dairy cow. Dairy ownership was one thing we didn't do until 2000. When we did it, all of our clients yelled a great big, hooray! They're dairy owners. Now they're going to really understand me. And I must admit, it changed our consulting approach a little bit. During all that consulting for dairies, we learned this kind of hierarchy on what we considered important. First thing we would always change going to work for a herd was nutrition. If we made the appropriate changes there, and it didn't happen in a week, sometimes it didn't happen in 6 months, made the appropriate decisions there, cow health improved, production improved, reproduction improved. And we had herdsmen come up to us, usually about the 6 month level, and say, I wanted to talk to you guys privately out here in the sick pen because there's nobody in the sick pen. And I'm not sure I deserve my salary. In fact, I think I'm going to lose my job. And they were serious. They thought they were going to lose their job because the sick cows had almost disappeared. But we said, there's a lot of other things we want you to do and the owner wants you to do. Financial health on a dairy is like this delicately balanced diamond up there. And I specifically chose that because there's a lot of money to be made in dairying if the weather doesn't get you. Our dairy suffered let's see, 17 years we were dairying, suffered a fire, a tornado. Out of 17 years, 4 years of drought that was so bad we had no pasture for our cows. That affects the balance of that diamond. Okay, our history. We were conventional, then we were certified organic, and then we were direct-to-consumer unpasteurized. We started out with 400 milk cows. In fact, Verizon told us they had never seen anybody go from zero organic cows to 400 organic cows as fast as we did. Said, we told them the answer. That's really, really simple. We wanted an organic milk contract. You gave us one, and we had to pay back our loan. We had to be milking 400 cows as fast as we possibly could because you told us that was the minimum you would accept. And the banker said, ooh, this is going to cost a lot of money. Yeah, it costs a lot of money. So we took a lot of risk. We didn't last very long in organic milk production. It's a long, long story. I can tell you very quickly that the reason we are not milking organic cows today is because in 2007, in January, when we called our, what we call growers in Colorado, our corn silage producer, our corn grain producer, and our alfalfa hay producer, and said, as an example, Mike in Kansas, Mike, it's Arden, Windsor Dairy, we got to talk about next year's contract. He said, I don't think we can do one. I said, what do you mean you don't think we can do one? Mike, we bought every kernel of corn you grew in the last 5 years, and we paid you on time. You've been so tickled, we've been so tickled, it's good corn, our cows have done well. He said, can't do it. You paid me $5.85 a bushel last year, and next year, the cost of organic corn is predicted to go to $12 to $14 a bushel. I said, oops, I hadn't heard that yet. Anyway, all of our suppliers went back to growing conventional corn. Our corn silage grower had had the organic pivots for 15 years, and he went back to conventional corn. Enough of that story. We told Organic Valley, we are selling our cows in June or July of this year, unless you give us a 275, 100 weight increase in price. And all of our fellow dairymen said, no way, you two are idiots. Now they've been still been calling. That was in 2007. I have still been getting phone calls. Hi, this is so-and-so from Wisconsin. I want to ask you a question, but first of all, I want to apologize. We were dead wrong when we told you we wouldn't give you a 275, 100 weight increase. We had no idea what was going to happen to feed prices. They all found out a half a year to a year and a half later, because it was terrible. Okay. Conventional first, then we certified organic. While we were certified organic, because Colorado passed the cow share law, we started a direct-to-consumer raw milk dairy. We were milking on two dairies, and we just put them on one of the dairies and fed them the same TMR. And then when we sold the 550 cows here and we ran out of steam flake corn, we were grass-fed. Why were we grass-fed? Because I wasn't going to buy any grain anymore, and we really thought grass-fed was the best food to produce for our family. And I believe that today. Okay. On our dairy, we produced raw milk cheese, raw beef, raw pork, and raw eggs. We had 1,800 layers at one time. We put them in half the dairy barn because our cows were out now. Didn't need the barn for anything, except for the maybe 15, 20 days a year when the cows wanted to be out of the wind. All those foods are high in omega-3. It was on purpose. It was intentional. Now, I want to share with you what our milk looked like in each of these situations for fatty acids. We tested our organic milk, we tested our grass-fed milk. We did not test the conventional milk. We weren't smart enough at that time to do that. In fact, I didn't have a lab I could do it at. So I took a milk evaluation study done in the United States. So that's on the conventional side here. So each of these graphs starts off with a US, meaning US conventional milk, based on actually two research studies, but mainly the last one. And then we got our Windsor Dairy organic milk, which also had flax in the diet. We fed about 4 pounds, a little less than 2 kilos. That's all I could buy. And then we've got our grass-fed milk over here, 100% grass-fed, no grain whatsoever. In fact, no minerals whatsoever except what was grown in the grass. They got grass and hay in the summertime, and in the wintertime they got hay. So, omega-6s. Here's a typical U.S. milk based on this study. Here's our organic milk, and here's our grass-fed milk. I think that's all the right direction and expected based on research. Here's omega-3 levels. Typical U.S. milk as of 2008, our organic milk, our grass-fed milk. Almost a four-fold increase. 0.6 to 0.3 ratio, likewise following just the math, but going from almost 10, 6 to 3 ratio, tenfold lower. Ones and twos, I wanted you to remember. That's ones and twos. I should point out that this is a winter diet. There was no grazing going on at that time. I purposely sampled that because these herds have no grazing for the most part. This was under grazing situations here, but the middle of September when I took that sample was a little late in our year for the most grass being available. We get to October, November, we have more again because it gets the days get cooler and the grass grows better. Here's the CLA, the difference from conventional milk to our organic milk up to grazing. Now, I keep putting the same slide up here again and again. Grass-fed milk is not milk. Organic milk is not conventional milk. There are huge differences, and those differences can make a huge difference for the cows. We are what our food animals eat, and diet makes a difference for people too, and kittens. You might not be able to see the kittens in the back, but Fiona, Sam, and Meg were all hanging on to a kitten. We would adopt the wild farm kittens every once in a while when their mom obviously wasn't there anymore, or when they were too laden with fleas or parasites or something. And we've had a lot of house kittens. So, switch subjects a little bit from fatty acids, which I think are, Bill, how long do I have?
I have till 3:45 and then 15 minutes for questions.
Got it. We're doing well. I caught up some. We're gonna look at our mastitis records. Now, in order for you to, appreciate where I'm coming from on this, I put this together for a talk I gave at the National Mastitis Council. They invited Meg and I to come and present our milk quality management at the National Mastitis Council. How many know the National Mastitis Council? Anybody? Okay. It's an international association of mainly milk processors, milk retailers, and the regulatory people. There are a few producers that end up there. There are veterinarians that go to that meeting. But when I was invited, actually Meg and I were both invited, but only I went, just like today. I have to be the materials handler, take the computer and go. When I was invited, there was an uprising in the National Mastitis Council. Why should somebody come and talk about raw milk in front of the people that spend their entire lives pasteurizing milk and writing all the rules about what you can or cannot do in your milk house or in your parlor? And even at breakfast before that presentation, I could see people talking over here, not hear my name. What in the heck is Nelson doing here talking about raw milk? Who approved that? I'm not going to pay my dues next year because we're talking about raw milk. It was a big, big deal. And it was fun. It was fun. I do my raw milk challenge there. I could have probably earned thousands of dollars because every one of them knew that pasteurized milk was not going to spoil. And raw milk could be gone in a day or two, especially outside the refrigerator. They have no clue about the bad things about pasteurization. So, utter health records. And I'm reminded of that because these are exact slides I made for them. Okay, in our consulting system, we have a records, and you can't see it in the back, I hate to say that, but this is a handwritten graph. Every month after DHI test, we sit down with Dairy Comp 305 and the bulk milk records, meaning looking at every single component test your milk has had when your milk is picked up, milk, fat, protein, lactose, somatic cells, bacteria counts, milk temperature. We graph all that stuff. We graph the diseases that your cattle have had in that month. And we divide about what we think is the appropriate divisor. On this particular one right here, it's the number of cows that have a new infection based on somatic cell count change, divided by the number of cows you milked on test day. Some of it's crude. Some of it's exactly statistically correct, okay? But the important thing we're after is, what did the trend do across 26 or 27 months of time? What did the trend do? And the trend in this herd, which happens to be our herd, was that we averaged about 2.5% or 3% new infections each month. If we're milking 100 cows, we'd have 2.5% or 3% new mastitis infections. Does anybody have an idea how good that number is? Is that high, low, average? You don't know because you haven't looked at it in your own herds. But this is a tip-off to what's going to happen next month, next month, next month, next month. If you start accumulating new infections, your cows can only handle so many of them, your antibiotic treatments can only handle so many of them. If you start accumulating more new infections every month, guess what happens to your somatic cell count? It goes up. Guess what happens to your clinical mastitis? It goes up. So the monitoring system is set up with a whole bunch of little tiny alarms. An alarm here would be, you see the line? If it goes above 5% of the herd, we're concerned. And we need to find out why it did that. We might not do it in 1 month because you can see over here 1 month we went up. And then this happens to be my own handwriting. Over here I put the X in the wrong spot. It was actually on another graph and I flipped the page and it did a stupid thing. So I crossed that one out. That wasn't right. It wasn't 5%, it was 2%. The point is we look. Why are we looking? Because it costs so much money not to look. And that's why Dairymen paid us. So we have, I think we ended up with 62 graphs, and many of the graphs, unlike this one, have one or two or three points on them. An example would be we have one that looks at somatic cell count by lactation. First lactation, second, and third and greater. Why do we do that? Because we want to find out before it gets bad. That's true of all these things. We want to find out before it gets bad. Okay. Data collected from DHI test. It's funny how sometimes you forget where you are and the slide just says everything you just said. Just a little off. Just click one more. DHI data, bulk tank milk data, on-farm shipped milk per cow per day. When we start working with a herd, most dairymen are a little pissed off at us that we want them to measure the bulk tank every day. If the dairy is so big that the bulk tank gets emptied more than once a day, the bulk tank has to be measured more than once a day. We want to measure ourselves how much milk we harvested, and we put it on a daily basis. We need to know that. It's not good enough to find out later, like 3 weeks later, that the milk's been going down every day. Now, you guys can't believe this. You can't believe that you wouldn't look at your milk shipped every time you get a slip, right? Right? You look at it every single shipment, right? Okay, that's good. And every dairyman I've ever worked for has done that. But every single dairyman ever worked for never took the number of cows that went into the tank and did the math. It's milk per cow per day. And we put it on a graph like the two-year one so we can see what the hell's going on. We want that. We want it to integrate with the fat and the protein and everything else. The Windsor Dairy data I'm showing you is a result of the averages of every month during that period. So it doesn't represent 1 month. It represents, in some situations, 2 years. And, well, for the period of production that we're looking at. So here's our clinical mastitis incidence. Conventional management shipped about 80 to 85 pounds of cow a day. We were on BST, 3X milking. Organic management shipped about 55 pounds of cow on average, 3X milking. And by the way, we were told we couldn't be organic because we milk three times a day. Did you know that? Did you know that was in the US organic code? It's not. Doesn't matter how many times a day you milk your cows, for Pete's sake. But anyway, organic and grass-fed. We actually milked our grass-fed cows sometimes once a day. You know how often we did that? Every Sunday, we milked once a day. So we could go to church. So the employees could go to church. So the employees that were milking didn't have to work on Sunday all day. And we didn't make any cheese on Sunday. Just put it in the vat. Okay, is anybody impressed by that? 43% of the cows we milk in a... Oh, that was good. 43% of the cows we milk in a year while we were conventional had clinical mastitis. Now that, of course, is a number that's reported by the people milking the cows. It's not a somatic cell number. That's a real live person saying, there's clots or flakes, or this milk is watery, or this quarter is swollen, and it gets written down, and then gets put in the computer. Anybody here think that's excessively high? Average? I want to see average hands. Average? How about excessively low? Does anybody think that's excessively low? Okay, I didn't give you the right choice, because that's low for American dairies and actually dairies around the world. That's low. Now you're sitting here saying, no way. I milk 100 cows and I don't have 43 cases of mastitis. It doesn't mean we treated them, okay? It means we detected something wrong with the milk and we didn't want to put that milk in the tank. Based on research and based on our consulting, that number is low. The real number on average is more like 50 to 60% of the cows have clinical mastitis in a year. Yes, sir. Milk production, I'm sorry I don't have that graph in here. 80 to 85 pounds shipped, 55 pounds shipped, 25 pounds shipped.
So there's a correlation there.
It sure looks like it to me.
But we should do a study.
What, you should do what?
A study.
A study?
Yeah, I think so.
Well, this is not a study. I'm just taking a snapshot. This happens to be one day that I went and decided to sample the milk and send it in and spend $300 on the test. Okay? Sorry, that's on the fatty acids. On this one, this is a result of many months of monthly data. Here it was 2 years. Here over here it's like 5 or 7 years. And here was 4 or 5 years. Now, I want to set that as a foundation or as a stage to talk about the rest of the things, because everything else I'm going to talk about is based off somatic cell counts on individual cows. And we're going to talk about things you don't see. This is something you can see. And what was interesting is as soon as we got here to organic, we had the same milking crew. We sold 400 cows before we got our organic heifers. And the milkers all said, well, we got less mastitis. And you know what Meg and I said? We went from a normal aged herd, okay, because we bought 3 herds when we started. So we had a normal ratio of first calf heifers, second, and adult cows. And then we went to all first calf heifers. Does anybody have a reason why there's less clinical mastitis milking all heifers?
They're cleaner.
Heifers are cleaner. They don't come in with a lot of infections typically. And so Meg and I told the milkers, well, that's expected because they're first calf heifers. And then next month they asked the same question. We said, well, that's expected because they're second calf heifers. not next month, next year. And we were kind of shocked at how much it changed. Now, you can say that that's all production stress. I've never bought production stress as an example of any cause for any disease, ever. Production stress does not exist in this guy's, in this brain. Doesn't exist. Now, there are all kinds of things that can happen as a result of having high milk production or trying to get to high milk production. But I don't believe that a cow giving 50 kilos of milk is going to get sick just because she's giving 50 kilos of milk compared to the 20 pound or 20 kilo milk. Now, on to the little things. Oh, by the way, we didn't use any antibiotics in there while we were organic or while we were grass-fed. We haven't used an antibiotic since 2007 on our dairy. Think that has anything to do with it? Would not using antibiotics decrease the incidence of clinical mastitis? Bill?
It should decrease it.
Should decrease it? Why? He thinks not using antibiotics should decrease clinical mastitis. Why in the world do you say that? He's not sure. We're going to put that on hold for just a little bit till we get over to some other graphs. Because I want you to leave here thinking analytically about this stuff I'm presenting, this last bit of stuff. This is not research. Okay, this is not research. This is just a snapshot across three different management levels with the same owners, the same facilities. Had a dairyman from Texas visit once. He put in a brand new parlor for his 1,000-cow dairy. I mean, he had all the bells and whistles in there, and it was going to solve his mastitis problem that he had. His mastitis problem, by the way, wasn't that terrible, but it was worth fixing. It was a father-son operation. The son was about 35 years old, and I said, Tom, you need to come visit our herd. You ever go to Colorado to hunt? And he says, I'm going to be up there hunting in a month. I said, fantastic. Then you're coming to our place. I took him for a tour in our parlor. I could tell by the look on his face that my mission had already been accomplished. Our parlor is a homemade parlor. It's got surge pulsators. It's got Germania takeoffs. It's got three different kinds of surge claws. I took the Germania claws out because we had too few of them. It was built in 1972. Most of the metal is rusting and falling down on the stall dividers. The takeoffs don't work anymore. Yes?
Is that all a vet can afford?
Yeah, it's all a vet can afford. And I could tell showing Tom our parlor, I said, now you're looking at all the equipment, and I want you to look at the equipment, but now I want you to watch Carmen milk. He said, why? I said, because it's not the equipment in here. It's Carmen. And Paul. And Jose, our three milkers. It's those three. And I said, after you do that, or at the same time, I want you to watch the cows. We got all done, and I said, okay, Tom, give me your conclusions. I was stayed in there with him. I made him stay there that long. Because he believed that having the latest equipment was going to solve his mastitis problem. His cows were too dirty, he didn't use enough bedding, and his milkers didn't give a shit. He needed to change those things. When we got all done, I said, what are your conclusions? He says, I'm so disappointed. You are such a good consultant. You've helped our dairy so much on nutrition and the money we spend treating cows and all this stuff. But he says, I'm really disappointed. You don't have a better parlor. And I said, I'm disappointed we don't have a better parlor too. I said, now we're going to go into the house and we're going to sit down and look at our mastitis records compared to your mastitis records. We were organic at the time, but so it's partly not fair. But what I wanted him to understand is it's not the equipment you have. If the equipment functions the way it's supposed to function. Now, our takeoffs didn't work, and I gave up trying to fix those things. They were ridiculous. But everything else in there worked. Everything else in there got monitored. And the most important thing is our cows were clean when they came into the parlor, and our teats were already clean when we pre-did them. And they were even cleaner when we wiped that pre-dip off. Our cows didn't have all the laminitis lesions that his cows had, because our cows had been fed right for 7 or 8 years at a time, and his had only been fed right for 7 or 8 months. All these things mount up and make huge differences on your cow's ability to cure herself. New infections across our herd. And I can show you graphs for whatever the number of years this is, 10 or 12 years, okay? But 4% of our cows each month on average gets a new infection based on somatic cell count, not something we can see. This is a cell count that goes into the infected area. We know that from research. It's the same all the way across these management changes. 4% of our herd had mastitis that was new this test day compared to last test day. That's all that is.
What do you consider the threshold?
Linear score of 4, 200,000. Good question. Here's subclinical mastitis resolution. Has anybody ever talked to you about mastitis resolution before? I'll bet not. I bet it's like the Lyon diet heart study. The important thing about mastitis is we want to keep the number of infections low. We do that by not creating new infections, and we do that by taking care of the infections that we have, or just letting the cows do it all by themselves. No antibiotics. Did I change that? Man, I'm good. That was a new infection level? That's our resolution. It got better and better. I should have put no antibiotics down there, but you know there's no antibiotics used in the organic or the grass-fed. Dry period new infections. It's the same test as on a lactating cow, but a lactating cow goes from this test day to that test day. This goes from before dry off to first freshening. What happened to her somatic cell count? When we were conventional, we had 30% new infections. When we were organic, we had 23. And when we're grass-fed, we have 18 during the dry period. Yes, Bill?
How do you detect that?
With somatic cell count.
If they're not milking?
Last test day before dry off, and first test day after freshening. Good question. Hopefully it was a good answer. Dry period infection resolution. Yes?
Is that the same dry cow program, or did anything change in the dry cow program?
Very good question. You people are thinking outside the box here. You're just not going to just take this stuff I'm spoon-feeding to you. You're going to question me. I don't like that. Think of what we could do if we stay tomorrow and the next day. That's a good question. Shoot. What was your question?
It's dry cow program.
Oh, very good. I thought I could back up here and find my antibiotic arrow. By dry cow program, do you mean dry cow treatment program?
Like ration, wine.
Ration, they're the same.
Everything you guys
need. Oh, that's not true. Over here, we fed a close-up dry cow ration to all our dry cows. Here, we fed a close-up dry cow ration to all our dry cows. Over here, we didn't have any close-up dry cow ration. Everybody, milking or dry, got the same ration. That's grass when there's grass, hay to supplement low grass times during grazing, and hay all winter with no supplements whatsoever, nothing. No, actually, the dry period was a little longer here in our grass-fed, which can influence the new infections and probably also influences the resolution. I mean, you're asking really good questions. Yes?
You said no supplements for grass-fed in the winter, so how do you keep the...
Well, grass-fed, by my definition, is no concentrates whatsoever. Our cows were getting... No, we didn't do it. Only in the organic herd. Our grass-fed cows didn't get any flax ever. Yes. Now, so your question really is, it'd be neat to look at this by season, wouldn't it? And I haven't done that. But we did look at the graphs every month when we graphed them, and we didn't see any indication of any difference. Very good question. So dry period infections get resolved better. That might have to do with a dry period that's a little bit longer and sometimes shorter. When we got down to our average of 40 cow size for our direct-to-consumer non-pasteurized milk, as a veterinarian, we got really, really lazy. We'd usually let Carmen decide when to dry a cow off. You know why? We didn't have any breeding dates. We got so lazy we didn't even write down when the bull was mounting a cow. I know that's pathetic, and I shouldn't confess that kind of thing to you here in public, but that's the way it was. We had so many other things to worry about, like, is the delivery truck running? Because we were delivering our products to three spots, and it'd take about a 200-mile trip to get there. Can we make cheese today? The cheese reefer isn't working. If it gets to 80 degrees, all that cheese will be spoiled, et cetera, et cetera. All of a sudden, checking cows for pregnancy, knowing when they got bred, wasn't very important anymore. As a veterinarian, when I tell that to other veterinarians that do dairy work, they cannot believe that I'm saying that. And I use that as an example of what it's like to run a dairy. If your loader isn't running that you use to feed the cows, it doesn't matter who's pregnant and who isn't. It doesn't. What matters is if you can feed the cows sometimes today. That's a little different subject. Okay. Overall culling rate. What could be the reasons for dramatic changes in udder health and culling? Now, you've already asked some of those questions, but this is my kind of list. Is it genetics or environment? We can manage genetics, but it's kind of a long-term payoff someday kind of thing. And I should also say, what about breed? Because our breeds did change in there. We started off 100% Holsteins when we switched to organic. We had 100% Holsteins before that. When we started the raw milk dairy, we picked Holsteins, Brown Swiss Holstein crosses, and then we bought some Jersey cows, and then we started using some artificial insemination. We put Vosgien, Montbéliard, Swedish Reds, Norwegian Reds. You name a dairy breed, it was in our raw milk dairy. You wouldn't recognize any of them, but it was there. So breed might have something to do with it. I'm going to say that it doesn't for ease of argument. Environment. Housing, bedding changes, labor changes, milking procedure changes, et cetera, et cetera. I think genetics is doubtful. It's no, 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 no. And did mastitis treatment change? The answer is yes. And nutrition changes? And the answer is a big yes. The same new infection rate by somatic cell count during lactation. We had less clinical mastitis. We had a better infection resolution rate, both lactating and dry, as we proceeded towards grass-fed, and less overall culling. Could it be diet? Now, this is not a question that I know the answer to, okay? I do not know it. There is not research to tell me the answer, and I haven't done enough research on our herd to be able to tell you what I think the answer is. But omega-3 increase and omega-6 decrease can facilitate all of what happened. Across the three management levels, we increased the amount of forage we fed to a cow in a day. That's going to increase the omega-3. We increased grazing. That's going to increase omega-3. We decreased corn. That's going to increase omega-3 and decrease omega-6. And we added flaxseed while we were going from conventional to organic. And that's going to increase omega-3 and omega-6. Pardon me?
How much flax did you feed him in?
Fit 4 pounds.
Flax all the way through organic and grass-fed?
No. Only while we were organic. And we probably only did that for 3 years, probably from 2004 to 2007.
Summer and winter?
Yes. Yeah, we fed it all the time.
How much?
You got it 4 pounds.
Per cow?
per cow.
Of meal?
No, whole, raw flaxseed.
Unprocessed?
Unprocessed. Pardon me? I can't hear.
Butterfat is okay?
Butterfat was fine. We can show you that too. We have information like you can't believe. So, I showed you this before, the pasture fatty acid analysis. The more pasture you feed, the more omega-3 you feed, which is linolenic. And the ratio of 6 to 3 in pasture is way more omega-3 than omega-6. In fact, the ratio is 0.27. And grain and linseed, grain and oilseed content when it comes to 6 and 3, it's too small for you to see in the back. Basically, corn is the example of a high omega-6 feed. It doesn't matter whether it's corn silage or corn grain, okay? It's just about all omega-6. Flaxseed, on the other hand, is over here. It's almost all, not almost all. It's 3/4 omega-3. Things like barley and wheat are in here. I put these in the order of increasing omega-3, and you can see where we end up. Pasture looks, of course, very much like the flaxseed. I'm going to suggest that it's a possibility for all of those changes. There are other things, too. Two more slides, and then we'll get to questions. Diet makes a difference for cows and people. And I mean that, cows and people. And the big thrill to me is realizing that the the intake of properly designed dairy products, meaning coming from cows with proper nutrition, might be able to change the health for one heck of a lot of individuals. And to that I say, ta-da! Bill.
Good questions.
Made them all too tired. Yes.
So when you bring your cows off of pasture for wintertime, what do you feed them? Like, is it hay or is it corn? Well, it won't be corn silage because you don't want that. Is it like fermented haylage? What is it?
Hey, we did feed some haylage 1 year, but basically in our dairy situation, it's been hay.
Dry hay.
It's hay we put up on our rented acres. We didn't put up... Guess I can't do that. We didn't put up any hay on our acres because it was all grazing. And we ate it all.
Like in the wintertime, we got up at all the
hay, hay and white salt blocks.
And no minerals?
We didn't feed any minerals. We were in such dire financial situation, we didn't buy anything to feed those cows except hay. And that's the truth.
And one other question. When I tell people this, they think I'm kind of crazy. When the cows go to pasture, like we drink raw milk from the tank, when the cows go to pasture for the first week or the second week, I get a huge boost in energy. Like, I don't know what's going on or what's in them. It's like, man, I can do anything.
They're different cows.
Like, and something's going on.
You meant the cow's energy or your energy?
My energy. Like, I don't know what's something in the milk that's giving me a... Like, I can do anything. It's like, yeah, a huge energy boost. And that happens every year.
From my experience, I think it's your head and your body.
More head than body?
No. I think it's probably about equal.
So would the omega-3 be higher and getting that?
Omega-3 supplements can treat clinical depression in human beings. Clinical depression. A person that today says, I think I'm going to end it. Can I borrow your gun? Omega-3 can treat those people. Seriously. Omega-3 can treat those people. Now, it doesn't cure everybody, but it helps a vast majority if they just have enough omega-3. The other thing...
I could be lacking omega-3?
Yeah. I haven't studied Canadians, but if you were a human in the United States, I'd bet a lot of money on you being deficient in omega-3.
Yeah.
It's just a fact of life. And it takes probably 2.5 to 3 days for your milk from your cows to get a boost in omega-3s and a decrease in omega-6 when you turn them out.
So thumbs bowling.
Now, the other part of it, the other part of it is just simply day length. Have you heard of seasonally affective disorder? It's a clinical depression. It's based on day length. And in my opinion, there's an awful lot of farmers, dairymen included, that have seasonally affective disorder. When spring comes and the days start getting long enough, you feel like possibilities are endless, and they're wonderful. In January and February, when you get the lowest light days, there are some people, the guy we rented the second farm from, he thinks about shooting himself about every Christmas. And he's the same single, divorced, ex-alcoholic that he's been for his entire life. But every Christmas, he thinks about shooting himself. You could not believe it's the same person when you find him this time of year. His field work's all done. He's happy as a lark.
So not, them blue silos that I seen in your picture there, you don't use them anymore?
We've never used that silo.
Never.
Ever. I wanted to convert it into a water tower after we had our fire. And I asked Harvest Store what it would cost to have them come, take it down, rebolt it so I could put water in it. We only lost 19 calves in that fire, but we were seriously close to losing our house and our shop and some cows. And if the neighbors hadn't come across the road before they even called us and opened our corral gates and chased the cows out, we would have lost cows. I had straw for a windbreak on the north side and the west side, and the straw caught on fire.
Margaret, sorry. Question. Go ahead.
My biggest, just talking about grass-fed, you didn't have the graph there with alfalfa. Everybody likes growing alfalfa. You get a lot of yield, you get a lot of protein. I don't grow alfalfa because I think it causes mastitis and foot problems. I aim for balage at 15-16% protein, early cut grass, sock it to them, and as dry or I feed balage with 30-35% moisture, and the cows, they
love
just
it.
Fill up.
Yeah.
It's, I don't know, we don't need protein. I don't know if you can harp on that. We don't need protein. We need sugar. We need glucose. We need energy. And you can get that in the grass. Your cows put on meat. They have meat on their ass. You can't get that with soybeans, corn, grain. Sorry, just, I'm...
Yes, 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 yes.
Okay.
Except for one thing. Cows don't like alfalfa.
Hey?
Cows do not like alfalfa growing in the pasture.
No.
Our cows will leave alfalfa and eat everything else until they're hungry enough, and then they'll eat the alfalfa and try and die.
I don't know how you can feed
some cows. I exaggerate. We did lose, we lost one milking heifer and two cows in the, whatever it is, the 10 years we were grass-fed with our small dairy. And that's really pisses you off when you go out and find them dead. Why would it be one cow when everybody else is just fine of the 48 you turned out there? Guess which one dies?
One ate the most.
Yeah, the best producer. Really pisses you off. Cows don't like alfalfa, in my opinion, until it's haylage or hay. And then they like it. But compared to everything else growing in the pasture, and we have 11 legumes in our pasture that I drilled in with our no-till drill, and that was a really good move. Seemed like a lot of money at the time, but it came up and did really well. Irrigated pastures, by the way, with the New Zealand K-line. Yes?
When did you stop feeding back seed when you went around them?
Why did we?
Yeah.
Because, well, there was no dairy standard for grass-fed dairy, but I didn't understand flax then like I do now, but it was based mainly on the idea that I'm not going to buy anything to feed our cows. They're going to eat grass. And I didn't even know at the time that we did that, that was 2005, I didn't even know at the time that grass-fed milk is going to be much lower in omega-3, much higher in omega-6 in the wintertime. Didn't know that. Sometimes things happen slowly. Yes? If I remember right, there are something like 20 states, and if Meg was here, she'd know the exact number. I keep looking for her to correct me, but she's not here. There's something like 20 states that have cow share laws, meaning that if you come to me and say, I want to be a member of your dairy. You pay me, A, a membership fee. B, you pay me a bottle fee, a startup bottle fee. And C, you pay me a monthly fee that's called boarding for your part of the herd. And in essence, and you also pay me a fee to buy a portion of our herd. We started out at $50. That buys you a part of a cow to provide you with 1/2 gallon of milk a week. That was called one share. But if you are not a member of a cow share, you cannot buy raw milk in Colorado. Now, if I remember right, Pennsylvania has raw milk that is licensed by the state, and they can sell that raw milk to anyone. You just have to meet their minimum test requirements for milk quality. Now, back to the flax. I am an active proponent of the fact that we should be feeding flaxseed to our cattle when we don't have green grass for them to graze. That was not approved by AGA in our new standards, American Grass-Fed Association, but I aim to get that in because I think it's crazy to not have milk that's roughly the same year-round. Now, it won't be as high in CLA during those months. Maybe we've got to figure that out, too. Yes? How much flaxseed? Well, I meant to have a slide prepared to do that, and I didn't have time. The flaxseed levels that have been fed in these experiments to change the fatty acid levels have ranged between 3 and 7 pounds. You'll have to do the conversion because I'm not smart enough.
That's the oil in, right?
That's whole flaxseed. That pregnancy loss study, 3 out of those 5 studies were whole flaxseed. No rolling, no crimping, nothing. Whole flaxseed. Now, when you feed whole flaxseed, which is what we did, and you preg check, you have flaxseed all up and down your sleeve. And you'll feel flaxseed if you're really careful, but it's about like feeling for a 30-day pregnancy. You can feel those seeds. As a dairy owner, that always pissed me off. Why should they be pooping out the feed that I paid $470 a ton for? Fact is, they will poop some out. It's so small, unless they get that flaxseed out of the rumen back up to chew the cud, its undamaged shell is going to prevent the oil from being used by the cow, and it goes out the poop chute.
Would you get more bang for your buck rolling it, you think?
Yes. more bang for your buck on having it absorbed in the cow. However, all of these vegetable oils, the polyunsaturated fats, upset rumen bugs. And that's where we had a question on fat test. If you feed too much free vegetable oil, almost no matter what kind of vegetable oil it is, you can upset the rumen biome, the population of various bacteria in there, so that they don't do their job as well. What really happens is that's kind of toxic to them, and they're going to spend their energy and their daytime trying to figure out how to make that less toxic.
So you want it passed.
You want it past the rumen. The last study done in Florida on the pregnancy losses, that study fed calcium salts of fish oil. Now, at least in the States, there are a couple of companies I'm not good at company names. Anyway, there are two companies that sell bypass fatty acids, which include or exclusively omega-3s. Now, that's the way to have the most efficient use of your omega-3 oil, but it also comes with a bigger price tag. We, being organic, had to buy organic flaxseed, and the only way I could process that is if I processed it myself. And I didn't have any way to roll it on the farm. Yes?
The slide you had on the mastitis reduction as you went conventional.
Clinical mastitis?
No, do you know what the profit?
Oh.
Milk also dropped on each one of those. But what was the profit per cow in those different scenarios?
I don't know that answer, but let me tell you this, which will give you a hint to what that answer probably was. We bought a dairy farm in 2000. We put 400 conventional cows on there because we were waiting for a $2 million research project to start, and we were going to use our own cows in that project. We got a phone call 2 weeks before that project was to start. This is after we installed the computerized research feeders in the barn. We purchased cows, we screened them for all these tests, and we could use about 200 of those cows in our study. Arden, this is John. Is Meg there? I said, no, John, I think she's at, John works for the company paying the research. I think she's at the dairy, try her cell phone. And he sounded, I thought he was personally sick or ill because he sounded so bad. I said, John, I'm on my way over there. I can just have her call you. What's the deal? He said, I'm not allowed to talk to you because you're the secondary investigator. I need to talk to the primary investigator. And I said to myself, oh, shit. I hung up the phone and I ran over to the dairy. It was 2 miles away. And said, Meg, did you get a call from John? She said, yeah, I sure did. Let's go in the house. And our research project was called off. They sold Bovatec. Hoffman and Roche sold Bovatec to another company that was not going to pay for any more research. That was not their method of operation. They weren't doing it. We were doing the last study. Meg had already done one for them. So our idea to have conventional cows that we could use as research was halted. And basically that halted any contracts, not because of us or the product or anything else, but basically since then there hasn't been any big dairy research projects. No company has had the cojones to say, we're going to spend $20 million developing a product that we can feed to dairy cows. Just not going to happen. Now, sorry about that long answer. That's when Horizon waltzed in and said, that contract you asked us about 5 years ago, we're willing to give it to you now. So we sold 400 conventional cows and bought 400 heifers. The raw milk dairy paid a lot of our debt from the original purchase of the farm, the purchase of 400 conventional cows, and the purchase of and sale of those, and the purchase of 400 heifers that were registered organic. The raw milk dairy milking 40 cows paid a lot of our debt. We didn't get anything above the absolute minimum paid when we were organic. We made money 6 months out of 5.5 years. Now, we had a lot of Organic Valley fellow members that would say, you guys need too much money for your milk, when we went to ask for our $275. And I would say, Bill, that's a very pointed observation on your part. What's your debt load? Oh, well, you know, I paid a little bit of money when my dad gave me the farm and my brother didn't want a farm. I said, well, we bought a farm. Before we bought our farm, we had some money. And we had some income coming after we bought it. And then we had no income. And the price of milk in the States at that time was in the toilet. I mean, we had to figure out what to do. And if Horizon hadn't waltzed in and said, we're ready to give you the contract now, we would have sold everything right then. It's over. But our 40-cow, unpasteurized milk dairy paid down a lot of our debt.
Rick, I kind of want to hear that question about Jersey milk cream.
I was wondering if you know if there's any statistical evidence that Jersey milk might be higher in omega-3s than Holstein milk or other breeds.
I don't know anything.
Okay. It's just a different color.
Sorry.
It's yellow, more yellow.
It's a different color. Do you know why it's yellow? I do.
Okay.
It's because Jersey cows and Guernsey cows and Ayrshire cows do not convert beta carotene efficiently into vitamin A. And that pigment called beta carotene is what makes the milk yellow.
Is it healthier or not healthy?
I'm convinced we need beta-carotene. I'm convinced cows need beta-carotene. We also need vitamin A. And I use the Jersey cow a lot as an example because she's so far removed from a Holstein. I mean, she's little. She's pissy. She shows heat really well. Six-month-old bulls will kill you. I have personally sold a bull that was 6 months old. It was 100% Jersey because he started charging people coming into the pen. 6 months old? Are you kidding me? 6 months old? Anyway.
Now they're
hockey.
All the time.
We raised them the same. All of our beef animals are bulls, intact bulls. We didn't castrate anybody. And we harvested them about 28 months old.
I had a whole barn full of Jersey bulls one time.
Must be me. Must be me. No, I don't know the difference. But the color of the milk is different because they don't process beta carotene as efficiently. Now, the other part of it is the fat is where the color is, okay? So if you take a glass of milk here that has a higher fat test versus one that has a lower fat test, even though they're both Jersey, okay, the color is going to be denser here because there's more fat. But color is an amazing thing. Beta carotene.
Thank you, Arden. This concludes our day. I've got a few things here yet. There's food in the kitchen. There's be leftover food. If you want to go to the kitchen and get some to feed your kids, you're welcome to it. I'd like to thank my colleagues on the advisory committee, Steve Hartman, Marty Prong, John Brunsfeld, and Stu Slater for helping put this together. I'd like to personally thank Dr. Nelson for a tremendous day full of great insights and knowledge sharing. I think that we've all learned something today that will help us be better dairy farmers on behalf of everyone. I'd like to thank you. I'd like to thank you very much, and I have a gift for you.